7 years old, third row pew, John 3:16, something changed in me, red letters coming off the page, flooding my heart with amazing grace. I knew then, I believed, and those roots run deep. Oh, I've been through some faith shaking hard times, yeah, but nothing's gonna make me forget.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Valley Mills, and welcome to those of you watching us online. We are very glad that you're here with us. If this is your first time here, we just want to say welcome to you and ask that if you wouldn't mind filling out a little connection card for us that we have out in the foyer. We do have a gift for you, but we just want to get to know you more and say thank you for coming. I do have one brief announcement for us. We have some serve opportunities just to help spruce up the church building and grounds before Easter. There's sign-up sheets at the info table, and you can also sign up via a form that was sent out in the e-news from Tanya Gonterman. So would you go ahead and stand at this time? And I see lots of green, as Stacy pointed out, so happy St. Patrick's Day to everybody as well. Oh, would you pray with me? Lord, we just give you praise and honor for this day, and we ask, Lord, that you be glorified through our worship, and may your presence just fill this place and touch every life here. In Jesus' name, amen.
Dark tried to hide and steal you away. Death tried to keep you inside of the grave. The enemy fought, he tried, but he lost. You cannot be stopped.
We declare that despite what we're feeling or what our circumstances may be, God, that we will choose to praise you. We will choose to give you praise, to glorify your name. And Lord, I just pray that as we do that, that our faith would grow, our faith would be strengthened, that we would grow deeper in knowing you. We thank you for that, Lord.
Over every day, God of mercy, please.
close your eyes right now. If you feel led to, you can raise your hands. But just focus on the Lord right now. Focus on what He's done for you. Focus on the blessings that you have in your life. Many of them undeserved, God. Every good and perfect gift comes from You.
If you want to go grab those, we'll take a minute. As we celebrate St. Patrick's Day, I watched a documentary on St. Patrick yesterday, and I did not realize that he was British, not Irish. Not sure why we wear green. But it was a fascinating, if you know anything about him, it was a fascinating story, and he was an incredible man. And I looked up how you become a saint according to the Catholic religion. And here's what I found out. Number one is you have to die. Number two, at least 5 years after death, they appoint an officer to gather information. Three, they gather all available written words by you and documents about you. They take statements from basically everyone who knew you. Four, that evidence must show that you have lived a life of heroic virtue, holiness, kindness, and devotion. There were a couple more, but these alone showed me I don't qualify to be a saint according to those qualifications. But the good news of the gospel is that the Bible tells us that because of Jesus and what he did for us on the cross, the moment we put our faith and trust in his finished work on the cross, we in God's sight become saints. Not because of what we do, but because of what he did for us. So I can tell you this morning, you don't have to die to be a saint, but you already are one. In almost every one of the Apostle Paul's letters in the New Testament, he calls the people he is writing to saints, even though their behavior was hardly anything sometimes but saintly. Because like every other identity and blessing we have in the New Testament, it is all a gift from God we receive, not a reward that we achieve. So as we partake of the bread that represents the tortured body and broken body of our Lord, and the juice that represents his blood shed to pay our sin debt in full, I pray we would be forever grateful for Jesus and what he has done for us. Matthew 26:26 says, while they were eating, Jesus took the bread, gave thanks and broke it, gave it to his disciples saying, take and eat, this is my body. Then he took the cup, gave thanks, offered to them, saying, drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine from now on until that day when I drink it anew with you in my Father's kingdom.
Good morning. Welcome to Valley Mills Christian Church. If this is your first time, we're so glad you're here. If this is your 100th time, we're so glad you're here. But if it's your first time, we have a free gift for you at the Welcome Center. We'd love to, for one, get to know you and know that you're here. And so just go up there, and they have that free gift, a nice coffee mug to add to your collection. Bob wanted me to let you know that he'll be in the pulpit in the next 2 weeks for next Sunday, and then Easter Sunday. With that, I want us to remind ourselves, Easter's coming, 2 weeks away. Easter is coming. Invite your friends, share stuff on social media about it. The biggest time people are open to coming to church are Easter and Christmas. So we have a big opportunity to influence hundreds of people with the gospel. So please, please don't waste it. Ask your neighbors, ask your relatives, ask your coworkers, everyone. Before we get in the message, would you pray with me? Dear God, just thank you so much that we can be in your house today, that we can worship you, that we can praise you, that we can learn and grow together. Thank you that you came and you died for us, that we can have new life. Dear God, help us to not waste that life. Help us to do something with that life. In your name, amen. So I had a very proud youth pastor moment this week. On Thursday, we went to Avon High School, and if you don't know, we have a lot of students who are involved in especially Mooresville and Decatur Central FCAs, also Plainfield FCAs, but they have been leading. They replanted FCAs at these schools, and we had what was called Fields of Faith at Avon High School on Thursday night. When all the storms were brewing, we were worshiping God in a gym with like 50 high schoolers, and it was amazing. And there's a picture of our students from Valley Mills and other places leading their fellow teens in worship and games and devotionals and testimonies. It was amazing. And so just give them a round of applause, because a lot of them are here, and we need to encourage the next generation that this is the kind of stuff they need to do. And I don't know about you, but when I was in high school, I probably didn't have an ounce of that kind of courage to get in front of 50 of my peers and talk about who I believe Jesus is and who Jesus truly is. And so I commend them, and they were so much more well-spoken than I ever could have imagined when I was their age. And so the next generation is doing amazing things. And with that, we also had Easter Jam yesterday. Tanya did an amazing job. Her volunteers did an amazing job of putting that on. We had 100 and plus people. I don't know how many people we had, but it was an amazing time where they shared the Easter story. And people who maybe weren't even Christians got to hear all about Jesus Christ. So it's amazing. Things are amazing that are going on here with the next generation. So let's get into the message. So we're going to be in Genesis 37, basically the whole chapter. And so we're going to talk about Joseph the teen. But before we get into that, I want to talk about the day I got ordained. So about 6 years ago, I believe it was October of 2017, right before I graduated, I decided I wanted to be ordained at my home church, which is First Christian Church in Brazil, Indiana, not too far away from here, about an hour west in little Brazil, Indiana. And at my church, I wanted to be ordained, and I was ordained by my old youth pastor. So my youth pastor was my youth pastor from sixth grade on to about 10th grade, and then he became the senior minister. A little bit about him, he had been in youth ministry for almost 30 years. So like he's a lifer. And so he was like 50-something years old when he actually transitioned into senior ministry. So he had been around the block a little bit. But also what you need to know about this guy, I love him to death, but you never knew what was going to come out of his mouth. Some of you know people like that. I'm sometimes a person like that. And so I think I learned it from him a few times. But when he's preaching, you never know what he's going to say. And so he's ordaining me, and he starts to talk about a cockroach. And I was like, cockroach was not on my bingo card of words I thought you would say today. But he starts talking about a cockroach, and he says, Craig, you need to be like a cockroach. And I was like, okay, where's that in the Bible? What are we talking about right now? Because I didn't think in my ordination I'd hear the word cockroach. But he starts talking about a cockroach, and what he is meaning is he's saying you need to survive and thrive. People are going to knock you down. This world's going to beat you down. Things are going to get difficult. And what I know now, 6 years into ministry, is there are going to be times you want to quit. There are going to be times you want to give up. And what he was saying is don't. Because God has called you and God needs you to do something. A little bit about cockroaches. I learned this through Google. They can survive 6 times to 15 times the lethal amount of radiation that we can. Like, all you have heard probably about how cockroaches can survive a nuclear bomb, right? And so this cockroach metaphor, which he probably doesn't even remember, but I remember, and it stuck with me to this day, is that we need to survive in ministry. Because there's going to be hills, there's going to be valleys, there's going to be Satan's attack on you, on the church, on your youth group. There's going to be things that beat you up and tear you down, but you need to be a cockroach and you need to survive it and thrive through it. And I think we are going to encounter a man who starts out as a teenager in this story in Genesis 37, who embodies the life of a cockroach. You probably weren't expecting to hear that on Sunday morning, but he does. He survives. He has the most roller coaster of a life you can see in the Bible. And what's crazy about this is we all know about Father Abraham, had many sons, right? Joseph had more screen time in the Bible than Abraham. He had more than Isaac. And he had more than Jacob. There are 14 chapters from Genesis 37 to 50. It's all about the life of Joseph. And it would make really, really good TV nowadays. There's drama, there's falls, there's highs, there's lows. It is a crazy life. And I think it shows us what's amazing about the Bible is it shows us, for one, what our life is going to look like. Our life will not always be climbing up the mountain. Sometimes it'll be getting kicked off the mountain and into the valley and rolling down the hill a little bit while you go down. Life will beat you up. People will beat you up. People will hate you and you will have trouble because you follow a guy named Jesus. He literally warns us about that. Because they hated me, they also will hate you. You and Joseph felt hate. But the thing is, he felt hate from the hands of his own brothers. But in Genesis 37, we're continuing our series. So Bob started with two people before Joseph. Who remembers who those are? Anybody? Samuel, the boy, and then who was last week? Miriam. And so Samuel, the boy, and then Miriam. And today we're going to talk about Joseph, the teen. And what I want us to know before we even begin today, you are never too young or too old for God to use you. You are never too young or too old for God to call you. I think for some of us, we think, oh, hold back. You're really young. Slow down. You don't know what you need to do in life yet. You don't know anything about life yet. Slow down. And then we get to a certain age, we feel like we can retire from a Christian life and just kind of sit in the pew and do nothing, and that is not true at all. Some of us think, man, I really wish I could have been a pastor, but I'm too old now. You are never too old for God to call you. We have to understand that age is just a number to God. God doesn't care how old you are, what you look like, what you smell like. He can use you and he will use you because he does this. He cares what he can do through you. A big part of the Bible is showing how people are imperfect, but imperfect, ordinary people can do extraordinary things through the hands of God. Because when you take God out of the equations, we can do basically nothing. For one, we wouldn't even exist. But without God, it's just a book full of mistakes by humans, and we're imperfect, but with God, we can do exceedingly more. No matter what you look like, smell like, no matter how old you are, how young you are. So let's dive into Genesis 37, starting verse 1. Jacob lived in the land of his father's sojournings, in the land of Canaan. These are the generations of Jacob. Joseph, being 17 years old, was pasturing the flock with his brothers. He was a boy with the sons of Bilhah and Zilpah. His father's wives and Joseph's brought a bad report of them to their father. Now Israel loved Joseph more than any other sons because he was the son of his old age. And he made him a robe of many colors. But when his brothers saw that their father loved him more than all his brothers, they hated him and could not speak peacefully to him. So a little bit about Joseph. He is 17 years old right now. 17 years old, he is young. He's not even legally a man in our society, and God is about to call him to do something. He's about to show him something, and he's going to go through a lot of hills and a lot of valleys in his life. And a little bit about Joseph is he was the son of Jacob, also called Israel. They're the same person. God just changed his name, but the writer of Genesis likes to switch back and forth. So when you see Jacob and Israel, the same person, unless they're talking about Israel, the nation. Kind of confusing. But at this point, it's Jacob, Israel, same person. So Jacob had married his mom, Rachel. But before he married Rachel, he got played by his father-in-law, Laban. Laban was a trickster and tricked the trickster, Jacob, and he tricked him into marrying his older daughter, Leah. Now, Jacob didn't want to marry Leah. The Bible says she was a little dim in the eyes. For us, we would say that's ugly, just so you know. And so she was not the pretty one. She was not the one who caught his eye. Rachel was. But Laban, when it was dark outside, switched the two brides, made him marry Leah. He had worked 7 years of his life waiting to marry Rachel. And it wasn't like he got to date her in the meantime. He was waiting 7 years. And then you know who he puts in front of him? The one who was dim in the eyes. He did not want Leah. He wanted Rachel. And so he eventually gets Rachel, but for another 7 years of work. So what that tells us about Jacob is that he really, really, really loved Rachel. And he plays favorites with her because obviously when you marry multiple women, that's not a good plan for success. because if you have a favorite wife, that's kind of messed up. And so that's what happened in this scenario. And so Rachel then was barren for a very long time. And Rachel, because she was barren for a long time, she felt like she wasn't loved, even though he truly loved her more. And then Leah held over her head that she had sons and that that was bringing her attention and love. And then finally, Rachel had a son, and that son's name was Joseph. And so no duh that Joseph would be the favorite, because Joseph being the favorite of the favorite wife is a no-brainer. And so not only does Jacob favor his son, he labels it, right? He takes a coat of many colors. It's been called many different things. My son calls it a rainbow jacket. That's his favorite story in the Bible right now. We read it like every night. Rainbow jacket. I want the rainbow jacket. He listens to like 2 minutes of it and then he's done. And so the coat of many colors, he puts it on him. It's a costly jacket because it's made of many colors and they don't have like all the easy access to colors like we do today. It's not like we go in tie-dye shirts for fun back then. Like they spent a lot of money on this. It was costly and it was distinguishing between him and his 11 other brothers. He was the favorite. Jacob favored him more than all. And what did that do to the rest of them? They made him hate Joseph. Kind of misdirected anger because Jacob's the one favoring them, but they hate Joseph because they wish they were Joseph. They were jealous. They wish they were Joseph. And also about this robe, what you need to understand is this actually was a long robe with long sleeves, not meant for working. It was meant for an overseer. And we're going to see that Joseph is an overseer. So not only is Joseph the favorite, but he's put in charge of his older brothers, and he gets to be a tattletale. Look at this in verse 5. Now, Joseph had a dream. Oh, we already saw that. But yeah, he tattletales on his brothers. And so now we're getting into the dreams of verse 5. Now, Joseph had a dream, and when he told it to his brothers, they hated him even more. He said to them, "Hear this dream that I have dreamed. Behold, we were binding sheaves in the field, and behold, my sheaf arose and stood upright. And behold, your sheaves gathered around it and bowed down to my sheaf." His brothers said to him, "Are you indeed going to reign over us? Or are you indeed going to rule over us?" So they hated him even more for his dreams and for his words. So we have Joseph the dreamer. Now the dreams, we know, are from God. They're foretelling the future. We know that Joseph is getting these dreams because it's predicting the future, and he is telling his brothers what he has dreamed, and they hate him all the more. To put it in context that we understand in Indiana, it's like you have corn stalks, and you have 12 brothers. 11 of them represent your other 11 brothers, and one represents you. Those bowed down, that one stood up, showing authority. And again, if we remember how God doesn't care how old you are, he doesn't care how you smell or what you look like or anything, he can use you. This was contrary to society. The older brothers don't serve the younger brothers. That's not how it works. That's not how society works in this day and age. But yet, he had a dream that's showing that all his brothers, young and old, will bow down to him. And it infuriated them. Look at verse 9. Then he dreamed another dream, and he told it to his brothers and said, "Behold, I have dreamed another dream. Behold, the sun, the moon, and 11 stars were bowing down to me." But when he told it to his father and to his brothers, his father rebuked him and said to him, "What is this dream that you have dreamed? Shall I and your mother and your brothers indeed come and bow ourselves to the ground before you?" And his brothers were jealous. They were jealous of him, but his father kept the saying in mind. So very countercultural, the father was the one to be bowed down to and respected. And we'll see later in Genesis that Joseph will bow down to his father, but he's saying that he is going to have power even over his dad and his mom and his brothers. He's going to be in such a place of authority that they will come and they will bow down. And we know hindsight 2020 because we know the rest of the story, that they will come to Egypt and Joseph will be in charge in Egypt and they will in fact bow down to him and he will rule over them. But they were jealous. Their hate began to grow and grow and grow. Verse 18, they saw him from afar, and before he came near to them, they conspired against him to kill him. They said to one another, here comes this dreamer. Come now, let us kill him. Throw him into one of the pits. Then we will say that a fierce animal has devoured him, and we will see what will become of his dreams. What I want us to see here is a blessing from God of a dream foretelling the future leads to trouble for Joseph. Joseph, who is going to check on his brothers, because remember, he's wearing the jacket that is for an overseer, going to check on his brothers and bring back a report. Nobody likes the boss usually, right? No one likes the manager. Remember? If you work, most people don't like their boss because you feel like you're doing all the work and they're just watching over you and yelling at you, right? Just like kids don't like teachers because they tell them what to do, right? And that's the same way what's going on right now. And so what should be a blessing, God telling him the future, becomes a curse for him, becomes something that makes his brother hate him all the more. And the thing is, we need to see this, that this hate grew into murder. You see, at first they were angry with their brother. Then they grew to hate him more and more and more. And that hate welled up into thoughts of murder. Very similar to Cain and Abel. Remember when Cain and Abel were brothers for a whole like chapter? Cain was angry with his brother. He was jealous of his brother, and that jealousy led to anger. That anger led to hate. And then God said, hold on, sin is crouching at the door. It desires to have you. He knew what Cain didn't know. Cain was letting jealousy go to anger, go to hate, go to murder. And what we need to understand is that sin in our life does usually not start as the big sin. It starts very small. Just kind of like how Goliath didn't start as Goliath, he started as a baby. It grows and grows and grows until you sin so greatly that murderous thoughts enter your brain. And they say something like this, we will see what will become of his dreams. They hated it. They hated him. They hated him so much that they would kill their own brother because they were jealous. And all of this was directed anger at someone whose fault it was not, because he didn't label himself the favorite. He didn't give himself the dreams. You can't force yourself to dream. God gave him that dream. But yet they hated him. And we know that was because God wanted this to take place. Look at verse 21. But when Reuben heard it, he rescued him out of the hands, saying, let us not take his life. And Reuben said to them, shed no blood. Throw him into this pit here in the wilderness. But do not lay a hand on him, that he might rescue him out of their hand to restore him to his father. So when Joseph came to his brothers, they stripped him of his robes, the robe of many colors that he wore. And they took him and threw him into the pit. The pit was empty. There was no water in it. So Reuben is the only one thinking rationally here. The rest are blinded by hate, blinded by jealousy, blinded by anger. And Reuben says, I want to save him. So let's not shed blood. Let's just throw him in a pit, leave him be. He won't get out. Maybe he'll die eventually. Maybe a ferocious animal will come and kill him, right? And so Reuben's whole plan is to put him in a pit, rescue him, take him to his dad, and tell probably his dad, like, hey, you need to protect him, right? But the brothers don't want to stop there. So they strip him immediately of that robe. They hated that robe. And I'm sure there's something in your sibling's life that you're like, if I could take that and just rip it to shreds, I would. Anytime they make you angry, I would take that and just yank it. If Peter ever got really mad at Keegan, he would take his train blank and just rip it to shreds probably, because that's his pride and joy. And so they got angry. So they stripped him of this. Now what we had to see is that Joseph came from a position of power. His dad had made him the favorite. He had blessing because God was blessing the descendants of Abraham, so they were wealthy. He had everything he needed, and he was at the high of his life. At a young age, at 17, he was fulfilling part of his purpose, and everything came crashing down when they ripped the robe off of him and threw him into a pit. Now, I have a good story. So this reminds me, I was looking through Facebook yesterday and I saw a picture of me and my wife when we were in college, and we were doing this ritual at Milligan called creaking. And this ritual at Milligan called creaking is not very violent for the women, but it's kind of violent for the men. So it's like a great day for females to be able to be creaked. So there's a Milligan Creek that ran, it's called Buffalo Creek, that would run right in front of Milligan. And so anytime someone got engaged, before they graduated, they had to be what was called creaked. Sounds like what you would assume it to be. You have to get thrown into a creek. But the way this starts is very much like Joseph. Joseph got ripped of his robe, right? For the men, they rip you of your clothes and you are only in underwear. And they tie you up and like kidnap you and put you in a truck, drive you around campus and honk and holler, and it's great. And then they take you to the creek and they throw you in the creek, and then you have to walk all the way back to your dorm room in your underwear. So I kind of know what Joseph feels like with the shame of being stripped from your robes and then thrown into a pit. Except mine was a creek. It did have water. I did bust my elbow. It was a great time. Just lovely. So there's my plug for going to Milligan. If you have a stick, go to Milligan. Maybe just get engaged the day after you graduate. But the joy of that is you sit there waiting in your dorm for a long time. Because Caroline and I got engaged our junior year. And so it could happen at any point. And so you kind of just have a little bit of anxiety when it's going to happen. You lock your doors every night. You put a chair in front of your door so they can't get in. But yeah, so you live in fear. So I was kind of okay that when it was over. But I understand, like, Joseph seeing the fear and the anger in people's eyes who were going to throw him into the pit. Like, I knew it was happening. I saw in their eyes, this is what you're going to do to me. And I was thrown in the creek just like Joseph was thrown in the pit. And Joseph is at a low point in his life. He's in a pit, much like all of us have been in a pit before. We felt alone and we felt helpless. Joseph felt alone and helpless, probably for the first time in his entire life. Remember, he was favored by his dad, had a high position, he was blessed, he didn't have to struggle one little bit, and now he's sitting in a pit with his brothers looking over him, hating him, with anger enough in their eyes to murder him. Then verse 25, then they sat down to eat. They have murder on their mind and they're sitting down to eat. It doesn't even give them a sick feeling in their stomach. They just sit down and eat. And looking up, they saw a caravan of Ishmaelites coming from Gilead with their camels bearing gum, balm, and myrrh. On their way to carry it down to Egypt. Then Judah said to his brother, what profit is it if we kill our brother and conceal his blood? Come, let us sell him to the Ishmaelites, and let not our hand be upon him, for he is our brother, our own flesh. And his brothers listened to him. Then the Midianite traders passed by, and they drew Joseph up and lifted him out of the pit and sold him to the Ishmaelites for 20 shekels of silver. They took Joseph to Egypt. Like, I just can't believe, like, they have no remorse for anything about what they're about to do. They just sit down and have a meal. They're like, it's fine. I'm kind of hungry. I guess murder makes you hungry. I don't really know. Never been there. But while Joseph is in a pit, probably trying to crawl his way out, crying, yelling, they're just eating a snack. And then they get an idea. You know what? Instead of murdering them, let's make a profit off of them. We wash our hands of it. Nobody's looking. Nobody has cameras. Nobody has phones to tell everybody what's going on. We're in the middle of the wilderness. We could sell him here. He'll go to Egypt. We'll never see him again. Plus, sell him here. He'll go to Egypt. We'll never see him again. Plus, get a little bit of green, right? We get a little bit of profit. It's like a win-win. Win. You don't have to kill him. You get money, and you never have to see that dreamer again. And that stinking coat that he has, I'll never have to see that again, right? They're so angry, so jealous, so bitter. Look at verse 29. When Reuben returned to the pit and saw that Joseph was not in the pit, he tore his clothes. So this was done without Reuben's opinion. He wasn't even around. He tore his clothes and returned to his brothers and said, "The boy is gone. And where shall I go?" He's stressing. Then they took Joseph's robes and slaughtered a goat and dipped the robe in blood. And they sent the robe of many colors and brought it to their father and said, "This we have found. Please identify whether it is your son's robe or not." Silly question, they already knew that. And he identified it and said, "It is my son's robe. A fierce animal has devoured him. Joseph is without doubt torn to pieces." Then Jacob tore his garments, put on sackcloth on his loins, and mourned for his son many days. All his sons and all his daughters rose up to comfort him, but he refused to be comforted and said, "No, I shall go down to Sheol to my son mourning." Thus his father wept for him. They added one more color to that robe of many colors, scarlet red of a goat. They killed an innocent goat to do their bidding. They dipped him in the blood and brought it to their father. I just can't imagine the whole time keeping this buried deep down for your brothers. Like, your father is mourning and wailing. He's torn his clothes, showing great distress, which was a sign of mourning back in the time. And all a while, you know exactly that Joseph is not dead. You sold him into slavery, and you know that your father could go and probably buy him back. But yet you sit there day after day, allowing your father to be in such distress and mourning because they had let jealousy lead to anger, lead to hate, and lead to wanting to murder. But instead, they wanted to turn a profit. And so Joseph went from the pit into slavery. He went from a place of authority, a place of blessing, to the pit, now to slavery. In Genesis 37, 36, it says, "Meanwhile, the Midianites had sold him to Egypt, to Potiphar, an officer of Pharaoh, the captain of the guard." So he's in slavery. And for you and I, we know the rest of the story. The whole story would take all day. But we all know, a lot of us know the rest of the story. He is going to go from a place of blessing to a place of the pit to slavery. But he's going to find opportunities in slavery to move his way up in Potiphar's house. He'll be second in command in Potiphar's house, but then he'll be falsely accused and thrown back into prison. He'll be in prison for many years, and then what will happen is eventually a cupbearer will come and a baker will come. They'll have dreams, and he'll interpret the dreams, and he'll say, "Remember me," and the cupbearer forgets. For 2 years, he sits and he waits in prison until finally one day Pharaoh has a dream, and that dream raises the attention of the cupbearer. Oh, yeah, there is a guy about 2 years ago still probably sitting in prison. And then he gets the opportunity to then lead again, to interpret dreams. Remember, the dreams were a blessing, but for a while it looked like a curse. And what I want us to see with Joseph's life is this. When God opens a door, you run through it. And when God closes a door, you wait and you remain ready for the next door to open. Everyone should write that down, put it on their door. When God opens a door, you run through it. When he closes it, you wait. The waiting may be the hardest part. The running through is the easy part, right? The waiting is hard. The prison was hard. The pit was hard. Joseph's life looks like a lot of ours, maybe just not on that degree, where we're up and down, up and down, up and down, in a pit, in prison, at the high, at the low. And the thing is, God is going and can use you and going to call you to something, whether you're young or old, whether you smell bad or smell good. He's going to use you. He's going to open a door for you, but you have to run through it. Because what if Joseph just sat there and said, no, God, I'm done. What if because of his brother's dream, brother's getting mad about his dreams, what if he said, no, I'm not dealing with dreams anymore? You know where he'd be sitting? In prison till the day he died. God gave him the ability to interpret dreams, but he had to use it. He had to say it. Because when God opens a door, no matter how big or how small, you have to run through it. Because when God opens the door, you work your tail off and you do what needs to be done. That's what Joseph did. He didn't sit down and say, woe is me, I'm in slavery. He said, no, God's opening a door in slavery that I can work my way up, that I can do amazing things in Potiphar's house. Your situation may not be your favorite situation that you're in, but God can open doors in that situation, and you got to run through it. The work you do may not look glamorous, it may not be awesome, it may not be your favorite thing to do, but if God opened that door, you run through it. And then there's going to be a time in your life when God's going to slam the door in your face and be like, wait. And that waiting can be hard, it can be painful, and it can be really long. But if God has shut the door, don't you get a crowbar and try to pry it open, because God shut that door on purpose. Maybe he wants to train you. Maybe he wants you to go through some trials and through tests to strengthen your faith. Work out in the meantime. Work your faith out in the meantime. And then when the door opens back, you run full speed ahead, because God made you for a purpose. And when that door opens, you gotta go. What if Joseph allowed his brothers to stop him? What if Joseph allowed Potiphar's wife to stop him? What if he allowed the 2 years of waiting for the cupbearer to remember him stop him? I can tell you what, we wouldn't be reading about him for 14 chapters in the book of Genesis. Let me ask you, what if you let what someone says about you dictate whether or not you walk through the door God clearly opens for you? What if you let what someone says or do to you dictate whether you walk through that door or not? Because we've all asked the question, are we good enough? Because other people have told us, you're not good enough. We've all thought, what if? But if God opens the door and he opened the door for you, then you better walk through, because he opened it for you. You can have every excuse in the book, but remember, the Bible is a book full of messed up people, ordinary people, who did extraordinary things through God. Quit thinking, what can I do, and think what God can do and has done. Remember at the beginning of this sermon, be a cockroach. You're going to get kicked down in this life. You're going to get name called. You're going to be at the end of your rope. You're going to struggle. You're going to be on the top of the mountain. You're going to get kicked off it. Be a cockroach. Remain steadfast. Be patient. I hate that word. Be patient. We're not patient in our culture. I'm not a patient person at all. But we're supposed to be patient. Because just like Joseph, maybe you'll go from the pit to prison to the palace. And if you remain faithful in Christ to the day you die, you'll make it to the palace. That palace may not be on earth. You may have a really, really, really hard life. But one day there's a palace. I want us to know this. The Christian faith is a marathon. Joseph's life shows us this to the T. It is a marathon. It is not a sprint. Because if it's a sprint, he would have quit at 17. It is a marathon. And when you run a marathon, I don't run marathons, obviously, but if you run a marathon, if you're crazy enough to do it, the thing about it is it's not finishing first. That's not the goal for most people, unless you just are a crazy freak athlete. The goal is to finish. The Christian life, the goal is not to win. You know who wins? Jesus. Your second best. No matter what you do, Jesus wins. You are trying to finish the race, trying to be steadfast, trying to continue on in your life, doing what God calls you to do through the highs and through the lows. In a marathon, you may get scrapes, you may get bruises, you may break your leg, you may do something that hurts, you may feel like quitting every single mile. You'll get shin splints halfway through. Like, it's hard. Maybe I should do it so I can testify to it one day, but that'd be a lot of work. But a marathon is hard. But you know, even for the people who finish in last, you know who's surrounding them when they cross that finish line that maybe they even took down already? The loved ones, their family, their friends who have been there through it all, welcoming them and encouraging them because you did it, you finished. And one day we're going to have a reunion in heaven where you're going to die, you're going to go to heaven, and you're going to have all these people surrounding them saying, "You did it." And you're like, "What did I do? I didn't finish first." We don't care. You did the race. You finished the race. You took every high, you took every low, and you ran with it, and you persevered. You were a cockroach. You survived. Joseph survived, but he also thrived. And God is calling us to that. Genesis 50:20 says, "As for you," this is Joseph. The brothers are there. We're skipping a lot of chapters. Go home and read it. But in chapter 50, it says, "As for you, the brothers, you meant evil against me." Remember, you were jealous. You were angry. You were hateful. And you wanted to murder me. But God meant it for good, to bring it about that many people should be kept alive as they are today. You see, God had a plan all along. And if Joseph would have quit when the door shut, many people could have died. His purpose for coming into power in Egypt, being second in command to Pharaoh, to then know and interpret the dreams of 7 years of abundance so we could store all the food into our storehouses, and then the 7 years of famine that are going to come, so many people would have starved. If he didn't trust God in the waiting, if he didn't trust God and persevere in the waiting, because then when that door opened to run through, you know what he would have done? "No, I quit. God clearly doesn't care about me. I've been sitting here for 2 years in prison." God cares about you no matter how long you've been sitting waiting for that door to open. You have to trust. The Christian life is a marathon. You're going to have highs and lows, but the beauty is we can win because what people intended for evil against Jesus, God intended for good. You see, they thought they won when they crucified Jesus Christ on the cross, but God intended it for good, and we're about to celebrate that in 2 weeks, and you need to invite everyone you know to hear the good news that death is conquered because they nailed him to the tree. But the tomb is empty. On the third day, he rose from the dead, conquered death for each of us, so that life, when it kicks us down, we still have hope. We still can go from the pit to prison to the palace. And all that's made possible because Jesus Christ died on the cross for you and me. So persevere, trust, because it's a marathon. Dear God, just thank you so much that you sustain us, that you that you show us true, real stories in the Bible about ordinary people, but an extraordinary God. Dear God, some people in this room are in the pit, some are in the prison, some are in the valley. Help us to trust you. Help us to be pulled up out of that. Dear God, I pray that when doors open, we run through them, that we can recognize those and we can run straight through them. Dear God, only you know what you're going to do with our lives. We don't know yet, but help us to be open to what you will do. Help us to be open to what you can do through us. Whether we're young, whether we're old, whether we're middle-aged, whether we, whatever, you can use us. In your name, amen.
And death by way.
away. Reminder, 2 weeks away is Easter. Invite your friends, invite your family, your neighbors. Would you pray with me? Dear God, just thank you so much that we could worship today, that we could praise you, that we could learn about you, that we could grow. Dear God, just open doors for us to run through, to work our tails off. Just help us to recognize those, help us to see those, and help us to do your will. Keep us safe. In your name, amen.